If it pleases the court, Your Honor. My name is Richard Hamlisch. I represent the appellant, Ronald Nardizzi, in this case. This case is many facets, but the ultimate issue in this case is whether a federal employee under NAFI, non-appropriated funds instrumentality, is precluded from any federal judicial review from an adverse employment action. That's the real issue in this case.
Just a minute. For damages.
Pardon?
For damages.
For damage and for equitable relief.
Well, for equitable relief, you didn't, I mean, you threw something into your brief asking to amend for equitable relief, but you never previously sought to amend for equitable relief, right?
It wasn't raised until the hearing, the final hearing on with Judge Fitzgerald. And at that point in time, I talked about reinstatement, and he sort of dismissed it, and it was not in the complaint, but I raised it at the hearing.
And it was a second complaint, right?
It was a second amendment.
You were given leave to amend once.
Yes. It was raised at the hearing.
But 99% of the case has been about damages. We can talk if you want at some point about whether you should be given leave to amend for equitable relief. But I just wanted to correct the fact that you somewhat overstated what the case was about.
Yes, you're absolutely correct. I would like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal.
Go ahead.
I guess the way to address this case is, number one, the Constitution, Article 3, Section 2, says federal courts have jurisdiction in all civil cases arising under the Constitution. Doesn't say that NAFI employees are precluded. But also, the Congress, the executive branch, the judicial branch, interpret the Constitution in many ways. And one of the things that Congress has done when it enacted the APA, the Administrative Protection Act, it gave...
APA doesn't provide for damages.
I'm sorry?
The APA doesn't provide for... It's not a waiver of sovereign immunity for a damages action.
No, I realize.
APA has nothing to do with this.
Well, the APA included NAFI employees in its provisions. That's what I started to say. Whereas when the CSRA, the Civil Service Act, was enacted, they specifically excluded NAFI employees. Now, why they did that, I'm not going to even guess. I've looked through the hearings, and there's no specific reason why they excluded NAFI employees, but they did. So the NAFI employees don't have any benefits.
And they also excluded judicial employees, and in Blankenship we said that you don't have a business action.
And they excluded I think the Veterans Affairs is excluded. There's a number of
How could we come out differently than we did in Blankenship?
That's my same question.
What's that?
How do we get around Blankenship in this case to get you to the relief that you want? Seems like Blankenship is a real problem for you, because the Ninth Circuit held not too long ago that court reporters don't have the very relief that you're now seeking. So why is the person who works at in the mess hall or the dining hall different than the court reporter?
Because the court reporters have other remedies other than CSRA remedies. NAFI employees don't have those remedies.
Well, you had remedies. You didn't care for them, and you say they're unconstitutional, but you had remedies.
The remedy we had, the remedy we had was to appeal, if you want to use the word, post-termination. In this particular case, there's a long history to why Mr. Nardizzi was terminated, but in any case, he was given a notice. The charges were not, and as I specified in my brief, the charges were not specific. He didn't know what they were, who they were made by, or anything about it. When we asked for that, they gave us 90 pieces of paper, 92 pieces of paper, by about 15 employees who were interviewed as to things that happened.
Counsel, now it seems like you're complaining about the process. So I guess the first question is that categorically, why is this situation different from Blankenship? And you said Blankenship had some sort of process where your client didn't. Are you saying that your client, as a matter of law, had no process, or that as a matter of fact in this case, the process was not properly followed?
Both. Actually, as a matter of law, the process provided by the Navy was not adequate. That's number one.
That's the personnel manual part.
That's the personnel manual. And I would call the court's attention, the Ninth Circuit case.
Just one comment. As far as I can tell, under Blankenship, she had, in fact, no process. You had some process. It appears from Blankenship that there was essentially nothing available. Is that wrong?
I'm sorry. I can't answer the question, Your Honor. It's been a long time since I read Blankenship.
That's a little odd that you're here arguing a case that directly depends on it.
I understand, Your Honor, and I did not review Blankenship.
Well, as far as I can tell, she had absolutely no process. Go ahead.
Whether Blankenship had any process or didn't, or the holding in that case does not obviate the rights of Mr. Nardizzi or any other federal employee, because we're in the fact that you're a federal employee, the Blankenship may be wrong. I don't know.
We're stuck with Blankenship.
Pardon?
We're stuck with Blankenship. This is a three-judge panel. So if you want to argue that the case court's taken in bank, that's a whole different thing. But Blankenship is the Bible as far as we're concerned in this case.
Well, if Blankenship is the Bible, then I think that this court has never addressed, as the Fourth and the Third have addressed, NAFTA employees, which are a separate category of employee.
Okay, that's a fair argument. You can say that Blankenship was CSRA, this is NAFI, and that's true. They are different. So, but why is it a difference that matters? That's what we need. Because for you to prevail in this case, at least from my perspective, you have to convince me that Blankenship is just a totally different animal, and that there are other circuit authorities that are right on point. But we're not bound by those, but we are bound by Blankenship. So give me the roadmap to get by Blankenship.
I don't think you're bound by Blankenship in a nasty environment.
Okay.
Because it's an entirely different situation than in I don't know this, whether court reporters in the federal court are Article 3 or Article 1 or Article 2. I don't know where they fall.
Article anything. They're employees of a branch of the government.
But. And I understand what I'm saying is the NAFTA employees have been treated differently since the enactment of CSRA. They're in a different category, and in all the cases, they say the same thing. Nothing. In two district court circuits, the second and the third and the fourth. They have said that, and I think the Mann case says they're not entitled to anything.
But Mr. Hamlisch, could we get back for a moment to Judge Owen's question? I think I might have even interrupted you in answering it, because I'm curious, too, as to which procedures you're objecting to. Because it seems to me that they follow the personnel manual procedures, but you're saying that those procedures are inadequate.
That's correct. That's correct.
But you acknowledged that there were procedures.
There were procedures.
Now, if the procedures were followed, would we have the same issues that we have here today?
The procedures were not adequate, Your Honor. I think that that's where we differ.
I'm just trying to figure out your argument. There were procedures in place.
Yes.
But you're saying that the procedures that were in place under the personnel manual were not followed. Is that right?
Well, they were not followed, nor are they adequate.
Tell me first how they're inadequate.
Number one, they're post-termination rather than pre-termination. Number two, the person who hears the appeal from the post-termination appeal is the same person who terminates you. So if I were to be an employee of Your Honor, and you decide to terminate me,
I guess that, that was the case because only, I guess, because he was as high up as he was. In other words, it's because the person who fired him was the head of the operation because he was a fairly high up guy.
Right.
For most people, it would not be the same person who fired him.
I don't know.
Did anybody try to object and say, well, because it's of this circumstance, we should have somebody else?
Yes, I did.
And they didn't say we can have somebody else?
They didn't even respond. They didn't respond.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't respond at all. Ms. Williams, I wrote a letter to Ms. Williams and a letter to her, the CO, no response.
Did you try to file, did you ever ask in court for the relief that you want a different decision maker as equitable relief rather than damages?
No, I did not, Your Honor. I never got that.
That sounds like a viable cause of action. I want a different.
It might be. I hadn't thought about that, to be honest. Okay. To get a replacement for review of the termination.
On the ground that there was a prospective denial of due process and you wanted an injunction to correct it. You didn't do that.
I didn't do that, Your Honor. That's a possibility which I hadn't thought of. But the going back to Your Honor's point, we believe the procedure is inadequate, at least in this case. And secondly, they didn't follow the procedure. So it's a two-step thing.
Counsel, you said you wanted to reserve some time. Do you want to do that?
Yeah. Oh, yes. I'm sorry.
Good morning, Your Honors. Assistant United States Attorney David Pincus representing the appellees and defendants.
And to be frank, it seems to me that the only question I have about this case is whether we should allow him at this juncture remand to allow him to amend the complaint to allege a claim for equitable relief. I know there are procedural problems. Would you agree that if he would have a claim for equitable relief for denial of due process?
No, I would not.
Why not?
Your Honor. First
why,
of all,
why doesn't the is it the FGE case?
First of all, the Stone case says that there are two important factors, neither of which is present here, that the employee had no alternative remedies, and also that he had a colorable constitutional claim.
Well, here his claim is about the procedures. So it's kind of circular to say he had no remedy. His complaint is that his remedy was a constitutional violation.
Your Honor, I believe there have been a number of misstatements that Mr. Hamlisch made that I need to correct.
Well, but that's his claim. I understand that you don't agree with it, but that's his claim.
No, the facts that he represented to you are not correct. First of all, this was never raised. The issue of equitable relief was never raised.
I mean, I don't know that. I was going to ask you that second. But first, I was trying to find out whether if it had been raised at the outset, would it be a viable claim?
I don't believe it would. First of all, he did have a completely adequate remedy. He had a right to rebut the charges against him. He never did that. That was pre-termination.
But that would be the decision on the claim. It wouldn't be whether he can raise it. I mean, in other words, if he could raise it, then the court could say, you lose because you had a perfectly adequate claim.
Well, the point, though, here is that he never bothered to. He never tried to rebut the charges against him. All he did was say, I want a pre-termination hearing. He wanted to create his own administrative appeal process, something different than what was provided. And he said, he basically said, if I don't get what I want, I'm not going to participate. That is, that I can't imagine how that could be a colorable constitutional claim. Also, with respect to post-termination remedies, there is no reason, it's complete speculation on Mr. Hamlisch's part that this Ms. Williams would have been the hearing officer. Here's how it works. There's step one grievance to the base commander, which is above Ms. Williams. It's the base commander who picks the hearing officer. It's complete speculation that Ms. Williams would have been the hearing officer, and I might add, that issue was never raised in either one of the plaintiff's complaints in this case. It was only put by Mr. Hamlisch in a brief. It's a complete bald conclusion of counsel. There's nothing in the record to support that. And the other thing is that the commanding officer is not bound by the recommendations of the hearing officer. The hearing officer would hear evidence, they could cross-examine witnesses, he was entitled to have a lawyer. But the hearing officer would only make a recommendation, which the commanding officer was not required to accept. And then, if in step two, if he didn't like the conclusion of the base commander, he could go to an individual in the headquarters of the Navy in Washington, the so-called SINC N9. There might have been some confusion that because Ms. Williams was the local N9, but she's certainly not the SINC N9, and I'm sure Mr. Hamlisch would agree with that. But the real point here is that Mr. Nardizzi never even asked for a post-termination hearing. And his claim seems to be premised on the idea that he had a constitutional right to a pre-termination hearing. That's not required under the Loudermill case. And this is a point that I keep making, but I have to make it again. Title V employees under CSRA are not entitled to a pre-termination hearing. They're entitled to notice and opportunity to be heard. And with respect to notice, if Mr. Hamlisch was not satisfied with the notice, he was given the 92 pages of documents, which had all the information. There's no reason why he couldn't have given a rebuttal. He just chose not to because, again, he wanted to create his own remedy. And that's just not a constitutionally required. We can't just let every employee decide for themselves what their remedy is going to be, their administrative remedy, and then say, if I don't get it, my constitutional rights have been violated. I completely agree with the court that the Blankenship case is dispositive. Actually, the court is correct. Blankenship had no administrative remedies whatsoever. And the court reporter is part of the accepted service under 5 U.S. Code 2103. And NAFI employees are considered federal employees for some things, but not for matters that are presided over by the Office of Personnel Management. And that's 5 U.S. Code 2105C. Actually, Mr. Nardizzi had more rights than the court reporter in Blankenship, and so there's no reason to distinguish the cases. I don't really have anything else to say.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Oh, just that we ask that you affirm the district court. It would have been futile for him.
Figure that out.
Yeah. It would have been futile for him to request a amendment of the complaint.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We have 2 minutes and 19 seconds left on the clock.
Just two things. And again, I have not reviewed Blankenship. I'm only relying on counsel's brief, which he filed. And in that brief, he mentions Blankenship. He cites Blankenship. And he says that Blankenship, the Congress provided an employee with certain benefits and withdrew others, such as review of adverse personnel decisions. Again, I haven't read Blankenship recently, but according to what counsel's brief says, that the Congress removed judicial review of federal court reporters. Now, whether that's true or not, I don't know, but that's what his brief says.
Well, counsel, maybe it makes sense after argument if you want to read Blankenship and submit to the court a 28J letter.
Okay.
Because again, no. I think a number of us have expressed concern with your argument with Blankenship, and since you haven't read the case, why don't we move on? You
can. Yeah. Okay. Just the only other thing is in the as far as futility of the post-termination hearing is pre-termination, we requested to interview the same people they interviewed. They refused to let us do that. They refused Mr. Nardizzi access to the base. He was on leave. So that our access to anything pre-termination was virtually nil except what they provided us. And they didn't even provide us with when and how these things happened. They said conduct unbecoming an official. What does that mean? When, why, and how? No explanation. And to this day, they have never explained any of that. With that, I will submit your
argument. Thank you very much. The case of Nardizzi versus Williams is submitted.